Today we're beginning a message series I'm calling Empowered. Everyone say Empowered. I believe God wants to empower us. And you might think it's a series, I'm just going to give you the secret. It's right here. You might think, well, it's a series on the Holy Spirit. Yeah, kind of. I'm just going to give you the secret right out of the bag. I'm going to try to help us let the Holy Spirit work in our lives in areas that sometimes we don't let him work in. And we need more of him in. Let me just put it that way. And so what I'm trying to help us do in this series is to really lean in and let God help us to live God-empowered lives. He wants to give us power. We don't have to be under the circumstances every morning. We don't have to be just kind of giving in to our emotions. We don't have to do all of that. We can live from a different place, and that's with God empowering us. And so I really believe you're going to grow in your walk with the Lord this month. I just want to challenge you to lean in to this series. So today's message is on empowered prayer. And I just want to ask you, what goes through your mind when you think of prayer? What do you think about? I promise for almost everyone listening, the word enjoyable did not come to mind. That was probably not what you were thinking. You didn't think that word. Some of you thought about tradition. Some of you thought about prayer as something that leaders do or pastors do. And I wish they'd shorten their prayers. Or maybe you think, well, you know, prayer is something that you got to have a certain lingo. And I've just never figured out the lingo to make this prayer thing work. And so for some of us, we're even thinking that prayer is really about convincing God to do what we want. You know, just, okay, how much do I think I can move God, and that's going to determine how much I'm going to pray? And if you don't think you can move God to change his mind about your situation, then you just say, well, you know, I'll just say an occasional prayer. But if you think he really changes things, then you'll pray more. So all of that's going on. And so, you know, we've all prayed prayers to convince God. Can we be honest? You know, we do that fairly regularly. I've done that. One time we were getting our house repaired, and I think I've told you this story, but it's good to remind her. The side of the house was open. It looked like rain, and I tried to convince God not to let it rain. And it didn't go that way. It rained. And I was really angry. And you know what happens sometimes? When we are praying for God to do something and he doesn't do it, we get angry. We get frustrated. We say, well, you know, I don't know how God's going to, if he can't do that, I mean, I think I see it in his word. I don't even know why I should bother praying, because he did not do what I asked him to do. And I want to encourage you that there's more to prayer than that. One of the things I learned as a young pastor is that most people are not praying much. I mean, maybe not even over all three meals a day. You know, we just kind of go about our life. And so, you know, when we don't enjoy prayer, we're not going to pray much. That's just the reality of it. And so my hope today is that this message really resets and recalibrates you in terms of your prayer life and how you're going to approach God during these 21 days of prayer. Because here's the thing I know, your prayers make a difference. They make a difference. And so in June of 1996, in the middle of the night, the Lord woke me up, and I heard these words. It hasn't happened often in my life, but this is one of those times. And I just heard these words: increased prayer brings the necessary adjustments. I was praying. I was doing what I thought I should do in prayer, but it really began to inform us as a church. And you know, God, I think God spared us a lot, because there's been an emphasis on prayer in this church for the life of the church since that moment. We've done it different ways, there's different methods, there's different things we can do, but there's always been an emphasis on prayer. And I want to just encourage you, God will do things when we increase our prayer level. He will make a move in our lives when we begin to do that. And so here's the thing we've got to understand. We really need to pray more than God needs us to pray. We need the prayer. more than God needs us to pray. You know, prayer was a discussion of Jesus and his disciples. They talked about it. And in fact, the disciples even asked Jesus to teach them how to pray. Why did they do that? Well, because they saw Jesus, you know, leaving in the middle of the night, and he was going, they figured out he was going to pray. I don't know, Peter probably went and spied on him one night. The Bible doesn't tell us, but you know, he would go off into the mountains, he'd go off into the hills, and he'd spend the time talking with his Father and praying. And so they asked. And so one of the things that Jesus told them on prayer is found in Matthew chapter 6, verses 7 and 8. It says, when you pray, not if you pray, when you pray, don't babble on and on as the Gentiles do. Well, we're Gentiles. Most of us are Gentiles. Most of you not of Hebrew descent. We're the Gentiles. Here's the thing. They think their prayers are answered merely by repeating their words again and again. Don't be like them, for your Father knows exactly what you need even before you ask him. Isn't that good? But this is powerful. We do not need to pray so God knows our prayer list. That's what he's saying here. God doesn't need you to pray so he knows what you want. He doesn't need you to pray so that you know so that he knows what's on your list. He already knows what's on your list. And some of us, our prayer life is we just get into the cycle of kind of repeating the same things over and over. And so, you know, he said you don't have to do that. But there's another verse. That's why we take the whole counsel of God. Amen. Luke 18, 1. One day Jesus told his disciples a story to show that they should always pray and never give up. So we got this. You don't have to be praying the same words over and over. But on the other hand, keep praying. Don't give up. Right? What's going on here? And really, if you read the parable, by the way, I'm going to give you lots of chapters to read. So I've got your daily Bible reading covered for this week. You just write down these chapters and go read them and look at the outline. It's going to help you with some things. So if you read in Luke 18 and you look at this parable, the lesson really was about persistent prayer pays off. There's going to be a result from persistent prayer. It brings the results that God wants to have. And so one of the results, this is the key, one of the results that persistent prayer brings about is change in us. Because remember, God doesn't need our prayer so we know he knows our list. He needs our prayer so he can change us. That's what he's trying to work through. And so Jesus ends the parable in verse 8, the last part. He says, but when the Son of Man, by the way, when you read your Bible and you see Son of Man, that's the phrase Jesus used to refer to himself. So Son of Man, when the Son of Man returns, how many will he find on the earth who have faith? Now, we're going to not spend a lot of time talking about faith today, but here's what it's really important for you to understand. You will not continue to pray if you do not have faith. If you do not believe that God's, like we sang, the way maker, that he can do some things, you won't pray. You'll just say, well, I don't know if he can do it. Let me pray and see if he does it. By the way, that's not faith. Faith is saying, God, I know you'll do it, so I'm just reminding you of your word today. Amen? So we've got to understand that. And so he's saying, in other words, well, I find people praying persistently when I return to the earth, when I come back. And so the problem is there's often some hindrances that keep us from prayer. And we've kind of touched on several of them, but I want to look at it from a different perspective a little bit. I'll go through these pretty quick. Here's the first one. Disappointing experiences. We all have prayers that don't seem to be answered. Anybody got those kind of prayers? Yep. I've got them. You've got them. And one of the big areas is the area of physical healing. You know, we prayed for so-and-so to get healed and to live, and what happens, you know? Here's what I believe. I believe the Bible's clear on. I believe it's God's desire and God's will for us to be healthy. Amen. And to fulfill our days. Amen. But I also know that John 10:10 tells us the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And so not every time that someone passes away before we think it's time, that's not necessarily God saying that's their time. That there is an enemy that's trying to steal, take their life, and take us out early. So we've got to remember that. We also have to remember that in the Garden of Eden, before sin came in the world, there was no sickness and there was no disease. There was none of that. going on. The way God created it, there was none of that. So then the question is, why don't some people get healed when they pray for physical healing? And we probably heard a lot of teachings about, well, you don't have enough faith, and I don't think that's always the case. Here's my answer to why some people don't get healed. I don't know. Because I don't know what's in their heart. I don't know what's going on. I can't say I know what's in God's heart. I don't even know all what the devil's trying to do. I don't know all that. That's above me. But here's the thing. I came to a place in college where I had a transition in my beliefs, really from what I would call passive faith to active faith. And I really had to walk this out. And one of the questions I had was healing. God, what's up with healing? What's the deal with that? And the question I had was, why did my grandfather die? Because I'm sure people prayed for his healing. Why did that happen? And I had an epiphany. I don't know, but I know I can trust God. I don't know, but I know I can trust God. And I think that's the place we have to get to with those prayers that are not answered in whatever area of life they are. I don't know, but I can trust God. I know he still loves me. I know he still wants to do a work in me. I know he still cares about me. So that can be a hindrance to prayers. Just, you know, circumstances that disappoint us. Here's another one. Prayer is not a priority. We can be hindered in our prayer walk when we actually don't make it a priority. By the way, when you say, I'm too busy for something, you're really saying it's not a priority right now. Okay, I know that y'all were shouting me down because I was preaching good, but that's right. It's the truth. If you say, well, I'm too busy. Well, then you're just saying it's not a priority, and I'm not judging you. But when we do not intentionally schedule things in our lives, we're really saying it's not a priority. I'm of the belief you put in your schedule what's important, right? You spend time with people that you think are important. You spend time doing activities that you think are important, and so. So it all comes back down to we need to make prayer a higher priority. And again, we need to pray more than God needs us to pray. Let me give you a tick off a few quick reasons why. Because prayer changes us and it changes circumstances and it changes others. It just changes things. Prayer works. It's not the prayer that's doing it. The prayer activates God doing some things in the spiritual, supernatural realm. The other thing prayer does is it transfers the weight of problems from us to God. Some of us are carrying around way too much weight because we're not praying enough. It's the transfer, okay? Bible says in Philippians 4 that prayer brings peace of heart and mind. Just brings peace when we pray. And prayer gives us strength. When we know that we're praying and we're communicating to God, sometimes strength comes not by additional strength, but by the release of the burdens that you were already carrying. I mean, if you put a backpack on with 50 pounds in it and carry it around for a while, when you got rid of that, you would say, oh, I feel stronger. It's just the weight's gone. So it affects our strength. So when we're not making prayer a priority, we're really saying, God, I can do this by myself. I got it. God, I got it. He said, Pastor, you're kind of strong. I'm trying to move you to a place where you want to pray more. Here's another thing that will hinder us in prayer is fear. Fear. For some of us that grew up in a very religious environment where prayers were with these and thous and thuses and saiths, all the King James stuff, you know, those were wonderful years, but some of you are still kind of scarred by that because you're like, I can't talk that way. And I want to just tell you, it's okay. You don't have to be afraid of that. You can speak from your heart, what's in your heart, with your language, with your words that you like. Some of us are even afraid of praying out loud. And we're afraid of praying out loud typically because we're thinking about who's in the room, not who we're praying to. I don't want to be embarrassed because I'm not going to say it right. Well, if you're saying it for the ones in the room, they're not the ones that are going to answer your prayer. So just say it to God. Amen? Some of us were afraid that God will not hear our prayer. And we'll talk about that in a minute. We're afraid that God will not answer our prayers as well as he does somebody else's prayers. That moves us to a bad place too. And here's what you need to know. Fear is just a tactic of the enemy to keep you from praying. He's just trying to shut your mouth. Here's another hindrance to prayer. I'm going to meddle a little bit. Sinful living. Yeah. Preach, Doug. It goes over good. You know, if you've not given your life to Jesus or you're trapped in a sin, I've got good news for you this morning. God will hear the prayer of repentance. He will hear that prayer that says, God, I'm turning from my ways. I'm turning to your ways. He'll hear that prayer every single time. Every time you need it, he'll hear that prayer. So here's the thing, though. Sinful living is less a hindrance to God, and it's more of a hindrance to us. You got to understand that. Remember back in the Garden of Eden, the Bible says in Genesis chapter 3 that God was walking around the garden and and that was his common practice. I think he spent time with Adam and Eve every single day. The Creator and the creation hanging out. But when Adam and Eve sinned, the Bible says they hid. They hid. Why? Shame. Guilt. They put their ideas of God's response on God instead of really seeing who he was. He was out walking, looking for him. And I think we do the same thing. When we mess up, when we miss it, you know, some of us, it takes, even if we ask forgiveness, it takes 3 days before we feel like we can ask God and talk to God again because, you know, he's probably mad. And here's the thing. Parents, I want to help you. This is free. This is a bonus. Not in the notes. This is going to be good for you, though. Parents, one of the best things we can do, and once we learn this principle, we changed some things in how we raised our kids. One of the best things you can do is not make your kids keep paying a price for things they did wrong for a long period of time. When we forgave, it doesn't mean there wasn't consequences sometimes. But we didn't have, you know, if you just get your act together, we didn't do that for 5 days till they kind of earned enough, you know, that we could act like we loved them again. And honestly, I think for many people, why they think God's ready to get them is because parents have held a grudge, come on, for a few days. No, we need to forgive. We need to love them. Once we learn this lesson as parents, man, we just poured out the love even if they had done something wrong. And while we enforce the consequences. It's a big thing because it conveys the heart of God to our kids. That was free. The cure for sinful living, though, is simply to turn away from it. Say, God, I blow it. And it's even okay to tell God and say, God, I'm struggling with this. I need your help to help me make this one and done. I'm not going to be trapped in this sin all the time. I'm going to be free of it. I want to walk free of this sin. Amen? And so, That's really what we need to do. Here's another one. And that is, and this is a big hindrance. Limited exposure to an atmosphere of prayer. Most of us never been around an atmosphere of prayer. We don't understand that. We don't know how it walks out, works out. And so, you know, many of us have been to prayer meetings where the leader is praying and speaking, and everyone is just passive. They're listening. And there's a place for that. I'm not against that. But I want to just say what I'm calling an atmosphere of prayer is better. It's better. I want to say better. So in an atmosphere, I'm going to give you some things about an atmosphere of prayer. In an atmosphere of prayer, worship is mixed with prayer. Why? Because when we begin to worship God, we begin to see how great he is and how majestic he is and how much he can work. What that does is that moves us to a place of faith. And we can believe God for not just the things we think he can do, but even greater things. Amen? You know, we just sang about a breakthrough. We sang about God moving to mountains. And whether it's physical or natural or things going on, God can still do those things. But we've got to be in an atmosphere where we can have that worked out in our life. Amen? Here's another thing about the atmosphere of prayer. In an atmosphere of prayer, people can pray quietly and out loud at the same time. Not the same people at the same time, but you can mix. You can pray quiet for a little bit. All of a sudden you pray out loud. It's just an atmosphere where that's happening among people. They're talking to the Lord. Because here's the thing. Prayer is a participation activity. It's an all play. We all get to do it. We all get to be a part of it. Amen? It's not passive. And prayer gatherings together are meant to be active. What are we doing? We're speaking to God in the supernatural realms about supernatural spiritual things. Can't be seen in the natural. So in an atmosphere of prayer, those not leading the prayer, listen, are actively and verbally agreeing with the prayer. So that's why if you've ever been in one of those atmospheres, you're going to hear things like, yes, amen, in Jesus' name. Yes, God, you can do it, Jesus. And I'm not saying those are the phrases you have to use, but you'll see that there's people doing that. What are they doing? They're operating in one of the most fundamental principles in the Bible, and that is the prayer of agreement. They're agreeing with the person praying. And Jesus said this in Matthew 18, verse 18 through 20. I tell you the truth, whatever you forbid on earth will be forbidden in heaven, and whatever you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven. I also tell you this, if two of you agree here on earth concerning anything you ask, my Father in heaven will do it for you. And we know the underlying thing is according to his word. For where two or three gather together as my followers, I am there among them. That's the atmosphere I want to be praying in. I want to be praying where people are in agreement and they're saying yes, and that needs to happen. And so what we're doing is we're all agreeing together as that prayer is happening. And why is that important? Because when we pray together, he said, where two or three are gathered together as my followers, I'm right there in the middle of it. I'm there. We often pray like God's way out there. But when we're gathered to pray, he's here. His presence is here with us when we pray. And I tell you, when you're in that kind of a prayer atmosphere, it's electric, it's dynamic, you can sense the presence of God in that atmosphere. I don't know about you, but that's where I want to be. I want to be in that kind of an atmosphere. Amen? Why? Because we're cooperating with God to see people's lives changed. It's a powerful, wonderful thing. And so, really, that's what we desire our gatherings during 21 days of prayer to be. We'll begin with a devotional. No one's going to call you up and say, I just see you here today. Would you give a devotional? No one's going to do that. Okay? We're going to get that taken care of. We're going to have some time of worship. We're going to have some time of personal prayer. We're going to have some time together where we agree and pray some things. We'll have different things we pray about each day. But we'll also be led of the Holy Spirit. We'll just pray over those things. And then when you're here in attendance, or even if you're watching online, whoever's praying, just be in agreement. I know I can't hear you when you're online, but if you're here, let me hear you. Amen? And just kind of be active. And it all begins tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. We're going to be in person. We're going to be live stream. And we're going to do that the next 3 weeks during the weekdays. And then on Saturdays, it's going to be at 9 a.m. And prayer will be an hour or less each day. And so I just want to, you know, we'll do a Texas style. I want to double dog dare you to participate. I just want you to, I want you to do it. I want you to get into it. Again, not because God's saying, boy, sure wish they'd pray more. He wants to do something in you. He knows your list, but he wants to do something in you. I don't know about you, but we have all probably never been alive in a time when our world, our nation, our community, our church, and ourselves personally need prayer more than we do now. I don't know. If you can't get motivated to prayer during this season, I don't know what it's going to take. Honestly, I don't know what it's going to take, right? So let's talk about this a little bit. What's prayer? What is prayer? And you might be thinking, well, Pastor, I know the answer to that question. And you may in part, but I want to stretch your thinking a little bit today. I want to expand your understanding, and I want to expand your relationship with God through prayer. Normally, what we think about in prayer is we think that prayer is one-sided. In other words, we tell God what we want or what we need, and then like a cosmic Coke machine, God, you know, if we put in the right change and we get it exactly right and we say the words exactly how he wants us to say them, then all of a sudden, and we push the button just right, ooh, all of a sudden coming out the bottom is going to be exactly what we want. We tend to look at prayer like that. God will answer my prayer if I do it right and give me what I want. And again, I want to say it this way. God is actually more interested in a relationship with you than he is in answering your prayers. And he wants to answer your prayers. So that tells you how much he wants a relationship with you. Well, some of you may be thinking, well, if he'd answer my prayers more, we'd have a better relationship. Right? We think that. And here's the thing. I believe that that's rarely the case. That's rarely the case. Most people seek God the most when they're the most desperate. It's just a human nature. In fact, Jesus had that experience. There was 10 lepers that came to Jesus in Luke 17, and they said, we need healing. Now, leprosy, you know, that may not mean much to you, but that was the coronavirus of their day. There was no cure. There was no way. They quarantined. Come on, all the same things as what they did with leprosy, and they came to Jesus. Okay? And Jesus healed them. You know how many came back to say a word to him? One. 10%. 10%. Do you know that in the American church, if you call a prayer meeting, the average percentage of the congregation that comes is around 10%? It's just interesting. I'd never seen that before, and I was studying this week. I thought, "What isn't that interesting?" Now, I'm not condemning you. I'm not trying to put you down, but I'm just saying we need that prayer. And it, just because we get our prayers answered doesn't mean we're going to do more. We're just going to say, "Oh, good, now I can go on to the next thing." And I want to say, let's be those that come back, and we not only say thanks, but we spend time with the one who answers our prayers. Amen? Let's do that together. So, here's a side thought. I wonder if we sought God more for relationship, we'd see more prayers answered. Just a thought. Think about parenting. Think on that. Which leads us again to the question, what is prayer? I'm going to give you three things here real quick. Number one, two-way communication with God. Most of us know that. It's, you know, if you got past the one-way communication, it's really two-way communication with God. Two pieces of that. We speak. We say things. We talk with God. We ask God for things. We tell him what's on our heart. Jesus taught us how to pray that way in Matthew chapter 6. You can read about it there. By the way, if you want some guidance on using Matthew chapter 6 to pray, we have prayer guides at the connection point and the exits, and online on our 21 Days of Prayer page on our website, hpfc.org. Go to the 21 Days of Prayer page. There's also a PDF online version of the prayer guide and our kids' prayer guide. So there's no excuses not to have any of those, right? But you can go learn more about it there. So we speak. There's some things we say. And then the second thing we do, and most of us don't do enough of this, and that is we listen. We just get quiet. Well, God, what are you saying? And by the way, the only thing God's going to whisper to you is what he's already said in his word. It's going to agree with what's in his word. Amen? So I would encourage you, if you're just getting started in prayer, you're growing in prayer, you've never really had much of a prayer life with God, this is a good place to start and a good aspect to begin with. Now, here's the other thing. I want to encourage you, all of you, to begin do more praying out loud. It's just something that happens in you when you hear you praying what God puts on your heart to pray. I don't know how to describe it. It just works. Amen? And by the way, you speak out loud with people you love all the time. If you love Jesus, why not speak out loud to him? Amen. Amen? Let's just think, he's real too. So that's the first two-way communication with God. Here, what's prayer? Prayer is a place we win the spiritual war. We win the spiritual war. There's an unseen world, the spiritual world around us. We can't see it. We can see the effects of it, but it's real. And we've got to pray until we win the war in the spiritual realm. You say, well, I don't know if that's true. I'll give you another chapter. I'm working your reading plan all week. Daniel chapter 10. Go read about it. An angel of the Lord appeared to Daniel. He was fasting and praying, you know, and 21 days, by the way. You just go read about it in Daniel chapter 10, and you'll see that there's a spiritual war. So every battle we face in the physical realm has a spiritual component to it. And we want to fight it in the natural realm, and what God's trying to teach us to do is to fight it in the spiritual realm. Amen? That's why our wristbands say pray first, because you got to win it in the spiritual realm before you can see God walk it out in the natural realm. You say, well, how long do I need to pray and stand on that thing? Until you get the victory. Okay? You just keep fighting, keep standing. So we pray because we're going to win, and we pray before we do anything in the natural. We pray first. Here's what Ephesians 6 says, verse 10. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. But again, see, all this stuff going on in the country, some of y'all, you're wasting lots of energy getting angry at people. I can't believe they posted that on social media. I thought they were my friend. Come on. I've had the thought. Anybody else? I'm just trying to save you some. That's not our enemy. We don't wrestle against them, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places, the unseen world. Okay? So if you want to learn more to pray this way, pick up one of those prayer guides. There's some things on there. We got some warfare prayers in there for you as well. And here's one more definition I don't think I've ever shared here, but I use it a lot in my daily prayer time. And it's reflect and learn in God's presence. Reflect and learn in God's presence. Here's what Psalm 139, 23 and 4 says. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. Point out anything in me that offends you and lead me along the path of everlasting life. So as you pray, God, what do I need to learn out of this situation? I've forgiven, I've let it go, but what do I need to learn? What do I need to change? What adjustments? What am I going to learn from what just happened? It's not just about learning, but it's also about change. I love what Pastor Wayne Cordero said. Prayer is thinking deeply about something in the presence of God. It's actually one of my favorite ways to pray. It's just to think in God's presence. Most of you know that for 30 plus years, my habit is a prayer walk. Every morning I get up and go pray. And by the way, let me just say, it's not because I'm super spiritual. It's not because I'm really disciplined. There's really two reasons. When I sit, I'm going to go to sleep. The other reason is I desperately need Jesus. I just need him. My life goes better. My day goes better when I have time with Jesus first thing in the morning. So I pray over various situations. I pray over people, our church, our leaders, you all. I pray in my prayer walk over all those things. But there's a significant part of my prayer time that I'm just walking and praying and talking with God and listening and sometimes not praying so much, but just thinking deeply about certain things that need decisions, asking for God's wisdom. And really, it's more than telling God what I need. It's asking him what to do. What's the direction? What's the path? Which way should I go? What should I do? And here's the thing about it. It is incredibly refreshing. And so for me, during 21 days of prayer, I continue my morning prayer walks. But when we gather weeknights, you know, some of you may you'll see me walking around here and you don't think I'm doing much. I'm thinking deeply in the presence of the Lord. Now, if I did that sitting in a chair, I'd be sleeping deeply in the presence of the Lord. And there's maybe a time for that as well. Amen? So it's one of the reasons I love our 21 days of prayer. Whether you sit, whether you stand, whether you walk, you can just be in God's presence. Amen? You can talk with God, but you can also just listen and hear what he has to say in your life. So with all of that as a background, let me give you three quick principles here that I think will really help you live empowered prayer. Here's the first one. Empowered prayer depends on the Holy Spirit. Depends on the Holy Spirit. You know, many things that we should be praying about, and if we don't know what to pray, we just open God's Word and it shows us what to pray. Amen? And so we can pray that. But what do you do when you don't know what to pray? Anybody ever had those situations? I'm not even sure what I should pray right now. All right, well, Romans chapter 8, verse 26 and 27 says, and the Holy Spirit helps us in our weakness. For example, we don't know what God wants us to pray for. But the Holy Spirit prays for us with groanings that cannot be expressed in words. If you ever just don't know, you just, you know, He'll help pray through you that way. And the Father who knows all hearts knows what the Spirit is saying, for the Spirit pleads for us believers in harmony with God's own will. It's interesting. This is a very specific passage about when we don't know what to pray, but when we rely and depend on the Holy Spirit, we'll actually be praying God's will. Pretty powerful, amen? Pretty powerful. So there's a lot to unpack, more than we have time for this morning, but the bottom line is the Holy Spirit is here to help us when we don't know what to pray. He wants to empower you to pray. He wants to empower you to pray His will. So just ask Him, say, Holy Spirit, I don't even know what to pray right now. Would you just help me? And you just begin to rely on Him. Now, if you want to know more about how the Holy Spirit helps us and all about that, I would encourage you to do two things. Join one of our prayer small groups. We usually have one every semester. And then also, the next time the Freedom Group is offered, get in that group, and that's going to help you learn how to lean into this area as well. And so, how do we pray empowered prayers? Just rely on the Holy Spirit. He wants to help you. Here's the second thing that we can do is empowered prayers trust God to answer. They trust God to answer. We're not just mindlessly saying something. God's going to answer. Here's what 1 John 5:14 says, and we are confident. Everyone say confident. Yeah, y'all said it like you weren't confident. Let's try that again. Say confident.
Confident.
Try it again. Say it like you know God's going to answer it.
Confident.
We are confident that He hears us whenever we ask for anything that pleases Him.
Amen.
Well, what pleases Him? And since we know He hears us when we make our request, we also know that He will give us what we ask for. So how do we know God hears us? We pray what pleases Him. What pleases Him? His word. Our obedience, right? Where do I start? We start praying for what's on God's heart. There's a lot of things in the Bible, but particularly in this season, I want to challenge us to pray for what's on God's heart. You say, well, Pastor, what is on God's heart? What does He want us to pray for? I mean, I got a whole list. Where do I start? It may not even be on your list. But I want to challenge you to put it on the list and put it first on the list. What's on God's heart? Think about that. What's on God's heart is lost things. Some of y'all, you've lost your phone. And you will turn the house, the car, the neighborhood. You will turn everything, every place you've been upside down. It will ruin your day. You'll get ticked off because you lost something. And when you lose something and you realize you don't know where that is, are you concerned about anything else? You got to find the lost thing. In fact, Jesus told three parables about this in Luke 15. There's another chapter for you to read. And it's about the lost coin, right? The lost sheep and the lost son. Three things. And I want to just encourage you, put lost things on the top of your list because lost things really concern God.
Amen.
I just tell you, I'm being a pastor this morning. It's not enough that you're here. It's not enough that you're watching online. He's glad you're here. He's glad you're watching. But you know what He's thinking about? And He, by the way, He can think about both, but He's thinking about who's not here. He's thinking about what can I do to work in the people that are here to make a difference in those that are not here. Jesus even said to pray to the Lord of the harvest to send forth laborers, workers, dream teamers into the harvest. That's what He's talking about. God wants you blessed. That's a given. But really what's on His mind is what's lost. So start your list there. Amen. 1 Timothy 2:4 says, God wants everyone to be saved and to understand the truth. Amen. Pray that God would help you have a heart for the lost in your life. Say, I don't know any lost people. You need some new friends. Or you need some new strangers. something. You need some lost people in your life. Amen. Pray that during this season, pray that God would help us as a church do better to help people know God, find freedom, discover purpose, and make a difference. We've got that. We talked about that a couple weeks ago. So before you do anything else during these 21 days of prayer, start with the lost. And not just pray for them, but pray for God, what do you want me to do about it? In this person's life, I want you to bake cookies. All right, I'll bake cookies. Whatever it is, just do it. Bless them. Love on them. Amen? It's going to make a difference in their lives, and it's going to make a difference in your life. Here's a thought I had. Prayer does not move God to do what we want. Prayer moves us to do what God wants. Just remember that. So how do we pray empowered prayers? We rely on the Holy Spirit. We trust that God will answer them. And then during those prayers, we build relationship with God. Remember, it's about relationship. Read John 17. There's another chapter for another day. John 17. It's one of the great prayers of Jesus talking to God before he was crucified. In verses 11 and 12, it says, "Now I'm departing from the world. They are staying here." Who's he talking? Who's the they? Disciples. He said, "But I'm coming to you. Holy Father, you've given me your name. Now protect them by the power of your name so that they will be united just as we are. During my time here, I protected them by the power of the name you gave me. I guarded them so that no one was lost except the one headed for destruction." That was Judas. "As the scriptures foretold." Here's the thing I want you to see out of this. Notice how Jesus talked about his connection with God. And he was connected. It was always, Jesus would go around and he'd minister, "The Father and I are one." It was all about relationship with him. Not just relationship with his disciples, but relationship with his heavenly Father. And so I want to just encourage you, lead and pray. Leaders, pray for your leaders. Pray for the people on your team, out of that relationship. But in this time, let's develop a relationship with God closer that's not based on a scorecard we're keeping with God. Let it be based on a relationship. So how do we experience the results of empowered prayers? We rely on the Holy Spirit. We trust that God's going to answer. And then we build that relationship that we have with God. Amen? Let's bow our heads in prayer this morning. Father, we come to you today and we just thank you that today, Lord, I know we've said a lot. Lord, that each person would just, that one thought, would just minister to them today. They would take that. They would hold on to that. Lord, they would use it to move forward in their relationship with you today. Lord, I pray over these next 21 days that this church would lean into prayer like never before. Father, we would believe you for greater things. Lord, we would hear your voice more clearly than we've ever heard you. Father, in some way, just put us inside our own bubble. Lord, the sports teams are having bubbles, protective environments. Lord, in some ways, just put us inside of that. I know the enemy wants to distract us from this time, this season of 21 days, but we just say no in the name of Jesus. God, we ask you to just put us in this place where we can grow like never before. We can connect with you like never before. Father, we're just desperate for you. We need you. God, we need you not because things are bad. We need you because we need you. Lord, I pray that every heart, every person listening to the sound of my voice, Lord, would just have an increased desire to be with you. Lord, that we would set down good things, that we would set aside even some important things just to be with you. God, because we know you can do more in a split second than we can do in a lifetime of labor. Lord, we need you. I need you. Say that with me. Say, I need you. Yes. So, Father, we thank you that you hear our prayer and you answer. In Jesus' name. With every head bowed, every eye closed, those of you that are watching online, just quiet everything around you. And I just have this question. Do you know Jesus? Do you have a relationship with Jesus? Now, I'm not asking you, do you do the religious thing? I'm asking you, do you have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ? You may know the fact that he died on the cross for your sins, but have you personally appropriated or accepted that fact as truth for your life? It's really as simple as flipping a switch. You're just going to decide. Say, yeah, I've done the church thing. I'm over it. No, today, open your heart. Just decide about Jesus. That you can open your heart to him. I want us to pray a prayer together. And those of you that are in the sound of my voice, just say it out loud if you're already a believer. And if you want to give your life to Jesus, just say it with us. And God's going to do a work in your life. Say this with me. Heavenly Father, I come to you today. I ask you to forgive me of my sins. I ask you to make me a new person from the inside out. God, I turn away from my old life and I turn to you. God, I believe you raised Jesus from the dead. And Jesus, I ask you to be my Lord, to lead my life. I surrender to you. In Jesus' name, amen.